Bubble Scat Tourniquets. Backwards has a great giveaway where you can win a tourniquet. I encourage you to subscribe to him. I'm subscribed to him and have a go at getting a tourniquet. I've asked mine to be passed along if I win, which I never do, that's fine. So I went to a few of the sites. People talk about tourniquets, they talk about trauma kits a lot. They don't really know what they're doing with them. A good first aid kit is probably a better thing than a tourniquet. But a tourniquet has a small place, and I want to talk about them because people are buying them and using them, and they probably should have access to stuff like that as long as they've got a large amount of sterile gauze. A lot of people have like a little bit of gauze and an Israeli bandage and sutures and tourniquets. You need a lot more dressings, the stuff you put on when it's bleeding, than you might think. Anyway. So, if you have a hemorrhage. There! Come here. They're agitating for bones. If you have a hemorrhage, a bleeding area, if it's oozing out, it's venous. If it's pulsing out, it's arterial. What you want to do is you want to make sure there's no debris in there, and then you want to occlude the actual direct area where it's hemorrhaging. If that fails to stop the blood flow, but reduces it hugely, you want to maintain direct pressure. Now, if it's an arm or a leg and you can, you want to raise it above the heart. Well, that's where your heart is, by the way, unless you're like me and you have two hearts and you have one there and one there. You raise it above your head for 10 to 15 to 20 minutes. If the blood, then you let go above the head and the blood stopped, that's fine. Then you put pressure on it again for another couple of minutes, then lower it to the level of the heart, put it off, no bleeding, that's okay. Leave it there for 2 to 3 minutes, then drop it down. Talk about significant bleeding here, like this deep blood, deep wounds. So you should not be reaching for the tourniquet to stop blood flow. You should be reaching for direct pressure. Press on it, squeeze on it, raise above the heart. The reason being that if you occlude one vessel, there's other vessels that can allow blood flow into and out of the arm. When you put a tourniquet on, there is no blood flow into or out of the arm, which is problematic, as we shall see. So all the studies they've done about using civilian tourniquets show that 90 to 95% of the use is wrong. They should have just used direct pressure. They put the person at risk from necrosis of the muscles, death of the muscles, permanent nerve damage, and in fact, loss of the limb. And also rhabdomyolysis, which is renal failure, kidney failure from all the toxins in the arm or the leg when they let the tourniquet off. So they're not the greatest thing to use if you can apply direct pressure. So another paper said 47% of gunshot tourniquets applications were actually incorrect for that reason. So you're looking at quite a lot of tourniquet use for that. Now the problem with the trauma kit that preppers have is that they don't have anything in it. They have a couple of Israeli bandages, a couple of pairs of latex gloves, I doubt they'll have a hemostat, they may have sutures, they will have some clot gel, and they will have a tourniquet. A lot of people are going to panic and they're going to pour clot gel in without cleaning the wound, which is then going to cause an infection and kill the person down the line. And or they're going to put a tourniquet on and bind it tight and leave it. The problem with putting a tourniquet on, it's a stopgap. There's no point putting a tourniquet on. It's best to let the person bleed to death unless you're actually prepared to fix the issue that's causing the hemorrhage. Because with direct pressure has failed, and usually arterial, it's pulsing, to stem the blood flow, you're going to have to tourniquet, seal off the area, wash it out, make sure there's no debris in there, open it further, visualize the area, using a hemostat, which is a metal forcep, go in there, tie off, clip with the forceps, maybe a bit of cautery if you can figure out how to do that, it's not that difficult. And certainly if you want to provide medical services, you need to provide cautery services for ORs. That's kind of one of the givens. But you don't even need to do that. You need to be able to suture off the artery or whatever, apply really direct pressure with the forceps. That will have the same as direct pressure, and you should still have blood flow around the arm, though it's going to be risky in terms of nerve damage and the rest of it. So before you grab the tourniquet, think about what you're doing and have some studies. Like go and learn some stuff, do a cert course, do a St. John's course. CPR courses are useless for this. CPR in grid down, waste of time, don't do it. CPR in the here and now is a great idea. CPR for parents should be mandatory for young children. Anyway, that's just a rant on that. So one of the things, reperfusion injuries and all of this stuff. So basically, I have a wound, I've applied direct pressure, I've raised it above the head, I've cleaned it out with water, sterile water, I've put a quick clot in there, I'm still applying direct pressure with a big pad above the head. It's still going, there's still blood coming out. What do I do? You put a tourniquet on. That's what you do. And then you get them to a centre where they can be treated. So in SHTF, that's going to be you. Or somebody in the neighbourhood who you happen to know as a doctor, a nurse, or a vet. Again, vets are really, really useful for this sort of stuff. And a lot of nurses have no idea what to do with it because they never see people hemorrhaging to death because they never work trauma or ER. Same with a lot of doctors. But anyway, pays your money, takes your choice. So, how long do you keep it on for? Do you know? If you have a tourniquet in your first aid kit, this is my question to you. What is the maximum length of time you leave the tourniquet? You ought to know. Research suggests 2 hours is the maximum length of time. After 2 hours, any benefit from the patient without a lot of tertiary care, they're definitely going to lose their arm use. They'll probably lose the actual physical arm. You'll probably have to cut it off, or the leg. And you'll probably also have to, you'll probably also get kidney damage and nerve damage. So about 2 hours. So if you apply a tourniquet, because you need to apply a tourniquet, you want to actually then use the stopping of the blood flow to actually clean it out, go in there and try and stop mechanically the artery that's bleeding, or the arteries that are bleeding. Or if you can't, chop the arm off. Sounds bad, right? But look at the Civil War. They had lots of guns, they shot each other. A lot of people lost legs and arms. You know, learn about how to apply combat tourniquets and all this stuff. One of the main things people do wrong, certainly in stress situations, is that they'll have a cut here, and then automatically they're going to put it on here like a blood pressure cuff. It's the same with the leg, they're going to go higher. You always want to go higher than the wound, but you only want to go about this much higher than the wound. So if the wound is here, the tourniquet will go here. This limits necrosis, this limits the damage distal beyond the tourniquet. Don't put it up here if it's there. Now the other thing is, if you find direct pressure here, you should know your arterial points above, so you can actually put pressure above as well as on the artery that's bleeding. That might work after 20 minutes and you may not need to put a tourniquet on and take risk. Now let's look at gunshots. I think most people are keeping tourniquets in their first aid kits because they think they're going to be shot. I think they hope somebody else will be shot and they can apply the tourniquet and save them, because I don't think a lot of preppers conceptualize their own deaths or severe injuries, because I don't think mentally they're able to go there, because one of the reasons they're prepping is they can't cope with death or suffering on a psychological basis. I'm not saying it's right or wrong, I'm just saying I think that's how it is. Most preppers with tourniquet kits probably have imagined putting the kit on somebody they love. They haven't really imagined putting it on themselves. And backwards actually shows putting it on somebody else, even though it's supposed to have a one-handed application. Chances are, backwards, that you're the one that has to put the tourniquet on yourself. So make sure everybody in your family knows how to put the tourniquet on you. One-handed application is quite difficult, despite what they claim. Certainly when you've been shot and having massive hemorrhage, it's going to be interesting to see how effectively you can open these packets and find them in the bottom of the first aid kit. All right, so the truth of the matter is, gunshot traumas in the field, in war zones, tend to cause people to bleed to death. The American Army did not use tourniquets for the issues that we had discussed, and now are using them because they found a place for them, and that's great. But one of the main bleed out leading to death in wartime is actually from two areas that a tourniquet, whereby in civilians, are useless. Neck, carotid, down here as well, slicing injuries like that, to actually tourniquet these are damn near impossible. So you really need to know how to apply pressure. You really need to know how to put intermittent pressure on arterial points and butt in towards the brain. Really risky, don't recommend it, but learn that stuff. The other point that kills people is from bleed out is pelvic. The pelvic girdle, a pelvic bones fracture, you can have massive bleed out from that. Now frankly, yes, you can put compression over the waist and do all those things. But we're talking here about types of surgical fix that just won't happen in SHTF. So effectively a tourniquet is going to be useful in about 50% of severe hemorrhaging wounds to arms and legs. It's not going to be effective for the other 50%, and it's going to put people at risk. So know the difference between when and where you should use a tourniquet and why. But most of the injuries that will kill people from gunshots in SHTF are the same as in wartime. They will not be able to be treated. Neck, deep clavicle cuts, and pelvic injuries, hemorrhage. Then we get into lungs, and we get into bellies, and liver shots, and spleen shots, and all that stuff. Basically, don't get shot, or you'll die. Anyway, do check out Backwards channel. Great channel. Enjoy it a lot. I might put some of these links in, I don't know. Basically, I said 2 hours. Most of the EMTs are being told quite clearly, tourniquet use, 30 minutes. They're just not happy about the death of the muscle tissue and the renal damage and the nerve damage. You should be able to provide control of the area that's bleeding after 30 minutes of shutdown from a tourniquet. What you'll see if you watch cowboy films is leather belts, and every 5 minutes they open it up for a minute and then they put it back on again. If the tourniquet is going to be on for an awfully long time before you know somebody's going to come back and be able to fix the bleeding point, that sort of has a place. I would recommend every 30 minutes to every hour you let it go gently. No. I recommend you let it go. This opens up the arteries and the veins. If you just let it open slowly, what you'll do is you'll actually open up the arteries, but not the veins. So you'll have blood flow into the area, but not out. So there'll be more chance of hemorrhage. So open it up quickly, leave it in place. As soon as it starts bleeding again, clamp it down again. It's going to reduce the chance of renal failure. It's going to reduce a lot of the other issues. But you are buying that with your own blood. And at a certain point, you won't be in a good state. So learn about hemorrhagic shock. Learn where arteries are. Learn where pressure points are to occlude arteries. Learn the difference between venous and arterial blood loss. Learn about the signs and symptoms of irreversible hemorrhagic shock, because there's no point treating people who are going to die in SHTF, right? Just don't waste gauze, don't waste gloves on people who are about to die. So know the differences and have fun, and au revoir.
Let's go, ready? From the top. My favorite shows on TV have 12 minutes of advertising. I can't get behind that kind of time.
Eat quickly, drive faster, make more money now. I can't get behind that.
My kids say, he said to me, and I'm like, and he's like, and she's like.